I would like to thank the organizers of the symposium for the invitation to come here and talk today. I shall also, like Troels Filtenborg, address Cito's portrait of King Christian II of Denmark. However, as Troels said, my paper will present the portrait in another perspective, that is, in a historical and art historical one, taking into consideration, of course, the results of Troels' research, as well as our colleagues in CAT's important work. I will begin by asking what we actually know about this artwork. As we shall see, we don't know very much, but we do know something. First of all, we know that it is a portrait of King Christian II of Denmark. We can say that for sure because we recognize his features, his iconography, I should rather call it, from numerous other portraits of him. Portraits, both woodcuts and paintings, carrying the king's identity markers in form of unambiguous inscriptions or weapons. You see some examples here. We also know when the work was painted, or at least when it was dated. Troels already showed you. You can see the date, 1515 at the top, but it is painted atop a varnish, which means that it was added after the painting had finished, was finished and varnished. How long time after is impossible to establish precisely. But as the varnish is thin, and as there's only this one layer, the date could have been added right after the varnish had dried up. But it is also possible that it was added after a longer period. As regards the technical circumstances, the work could thus have been executed in 1514 with a later added date, as well as in 1515, or even somewhat later. Furthermore, we know that the 1st of June, 1514, the customs official in Elsinore, Hans Pedersen Lillefeldt, wrote to Christian II that Mester Mikkel, that is Cito, had arrived from Reval. He writes, "My dear Lord, I hereby inform your lordship that I will send the painter, Master Mikkel, to you, the painter that your lordship today has written to me about." That is to say, we know that Cito was in Elsinore on the 1st of June, 1514, that he was to be sent to the king's residence in Copenhagen, and furthermore, that the king was expecting Cito's visit. Christian II, in other words, knew that he was coming. In the document, however, we do not read anything about what Cito was supposed to do in Copenhagen, or by whom he had been commissioned to come, or for how long time he was scheduled to stay. The next we know about Cito's whereabouts is that he was in Mechelen in the Netherlands in March 1515. Nobody knows what he had been doing in the meantime or where he had been staying. Finally, we know that Cito's portrait of Christian II is painted atop of another portrait, as Troels have shown. And that he said that we have been aware of that since the 1960s, so it's not a new discovery. Only now, new photoanalytic techniques have allowed us to get a clearer idea of what this portrait actually looks like. In spite of this, we still cannot say with certainty who the portrait person is. Is it the young Archduke Charles, his brother Ferdinand, or maybe their father Philip the Handsome? There's no doubt, though, that we are dealing with a male member of the Habsburg family, and a lot of factors, in fact, point towards Charles. These are the facts that we know, that we have to our disposal. Of course, we also have the insight that the conservators and technicians have brought about recently, but the new information has not had any radical impact on the art historical perspective. So from this point on, it will be speculation. And this poor fact situation, if I may call it so, produces a lot of rather fundamental questions. Who commissioned the work? What was its mission? How did it end up in Copenhagen? And not least, who actually painted it, and why on an already used panel? We know nothing about all this, but I believe that we can answer at least some of the questions by considering the work in its historical context. It is such an exercise that I will present in the following. I will begin my speculation by giving some background information. Christian II is one of the most fascinating kings Denmark ever had. He ruled for only 10 years, from 1513 to 1523. During this period, he basically transformed the social order in ways that especially frustrated the nobility. These changes produced conflicts that in the end forced the king in exile. He went to the Netherlands, and from there, about 10 years later, he tried to reconquer his kingdoms. However, instead of regaining his lands, he was taken prisoner by the new king, Frederick I, and he, that is to say Christian, spent the rest of his life in captivity. During his life in freedom, Christian II commissioned a great number of portraits of himself and his family. Many of them are still preserved in European collections, and a single one in the United States, but others we only know because they are mentioned in sources, particularly inventories. Some more examples. Christian chose the most famous German and Netherlandish artist of the time to execute the portraits. Dürer, Gossard, Bernard van Orley, Joos van Cleve, Quintin Metzis, Cranach, as well as Sitow, who is Estonian indeed, but worked in a Netherlandish tradition and for Netherlandish patrons. And Christian commissioned not only painted portraits. In his exile, he needed to broaden his self-promotion, so he began to aim also at the new techniques of mass communication, that is, the graphic portrait, easy to distribute and less expensive. Sitow's portrait was the first in this long row. Traditionally, it is understood as a wedding portrait. In 1514, Christian married Isabella of Austria, a grandchild of Emperor Maximilian and a sister to the coming Charles V. However, it cannot be a wedding portrait, as the wedding contract was already sealed on the 29th of April 1514, and the wedding celebrated in Brussels on the 11th of June. By proxy, because the king was to be crowned on the same day in the Cathedral of Copenhagen. Sitow, however, did not arrive in Elsinore until the 1st of June 1514, and from there he was to be sent to Copenhagen by ship when an opportunity occurred. When he actually arrived in Copenhagen, we do not know. But if Sitov's portrait is not a wedding portrait of the kind traditionally exchanged before the wedding, what is the painting then? What was the intended purpose of it? And why is it painted on a used panel? Several theories have been put forward in an attempt to answer these questions. And quite a lot of creative thinking has been required to make the various pieces of the puzzle fit together. None of the theories are entirely convincing, and all are speculative in the sense that there is quite simply no documentation we know of to support them. In my view, it is most likely, although no less speculative, that the portrait Sitov painted in Copenhagen in either 1514 or 1515 is a different portrait from the one found at the Statens Museum today. After all, why and when would the king have received or acquired a portrait of Charles or Ferdinand or Philip? It would have been had made more sense for him to receive one of Isabella. What actually he might have done, we just don't know about it. But if for some unknown reason he had received such a portrait of a Habsburg prince, it would have been quite strange and rather impolite to reuse a panel for another portrait, even if it was partly damaged, as we have heard it might have been. It must have represented a considerable value also politically. Furthermore, the king knew that Sitov should come. He waited for him. Therefore, also Sitov must have known that he was expected to work. And he must have prepared himself for a specific commission, that is, brought with him what was needed for the execution of it. As it was too late for him to be expected to participate in the preparations for the crowning celebrations in the cathedral, which was to take place on the 11th of June, a portrait commission is the most likely purpose of Sitov's stay. When finished, Sitov's portrait would have been sent to the Netherlands with Sitov himself or with someone else, where Isabella and her noble family saw and presumably admired it. Sitov was a highly acclaimed artist at the Habsburg courts. And given that Christian II was now an important member of the Habsburg family, they would have wished to have him represented in the family's various prestigious portrait galleries. Emperor Maximilian, Charles, and particularly Margaret of Austria all owned large portrait collections. Christian II was a new figure on the European political scene, and the Habsburgs wanted to promote him as their new powerful ally. Because of this promotion project, Sitov very likely was commissioned to do a replica of the portrait, possibly more than one. And one of these was sent along with Isabella when she set out for Denmark in late July 1515. When painting this replica, the artist would then have reused a panel that previously bore a portrait of a male Habsburg, a portrait for some reason no longer wanted, and probably given to Sitov for repainting by the patrons of the commission. We do not know what happened to the first painting, the one executed in Copenhagen, nor to any other of the possible replicas. If the portrait in Statens Museum really is a replica, it is though very close to Sitov as far as we know him, and very likely painted by him himself. as to the so-called weak hand, that is the king's particularly misshaped and unsuccessful right hand, we can only guess what the reason might have been. It is a mystery. Apparently, it was neither damaged nor repaired. This condition has been regarded as evidence for the portrait being painted by an assistant in Citeaux's workshop. However, I do not believe that we can conclude so necessarily. On the other hand, I do not have any other convincing explanation to present. The next question is, who commissioned the portrait? Who directed Citeaux to Copenhagen? We have no sources on which to rely here either. We know nothing about the communication between the three parties involved in the matter. Christian II, Isabella's family, probably represented by Margaret of Austria, one of the leading Habsburgs, and in mother's place to Isabella, and Citeaux. Did Margaret ask Citeaux, her former highly esteemed court painter, to make a stop in Copenhagen on his way from Reval to the Netherlands in order to paint Christian II's portrait, her new important ally? Or did the king ask Citeaux to come in from Reval to portray him in order to promote himself in the Netherlands? Both scenarios are likely. Whatever the case may be, it was certainly in the best interest of both Christian II and Margaret of Austria that the king, with the help of a famous artist well esteemed by the Habsburgs, became a familiar face, quite literally, among Isabella's family in the Netherlands. Thus, I believe that Citeaux's portrait was not meant to show Isabella the man she had married, but intended to present and promote Christian to her illustrious family and to the European political leaders as such. And Citeaux's portrait can only be said to have proven effective. Christian II was certainly satisfied with it, for all the portraits that can be linked to him in the years that followed point back to this work, using it as a frame of reference. From this, we may conclude that the iconography of Christian II was firmly established with Citeaux's portrait painting, seemingly to the satisfaction of all. This was how the king was to be depicted in the future. Gossard's and Cranach's profile portraits from the 1520s are only the only variation of this scheme. Thus, Citeaux's portrait must be considered to be the one portrayal that first constructs Christian II as the king he wished to appear as. And the iconographic formula draws authority from the portraits of male Habsburgs, which Citeaux obviously knew well, although his style was different, more modern, and therefore maybe more appreciated. A three-quarter profile, monochrome background, visible hand or hands, a large fashionable hat, exactly the kind of iconography observed also by the hidden portrait. This means that the social status and power that these princes conveyed in their portraits become transferred to the portrait of Christian II by referring to these familiar and exemplary predecessors. He becomes a competent and powerful ruler like them. In conclusion, let me sum up the main points of my talk. Citeaux's portrait of Christian II was a promotion or self-promotion project designed for the Netherlandish Habsburgs courts, and as well as for the European political scene as such. It constitutes the matrix of all later portraits of the king. It followed the formula of the contemporary Habsburg portraits of male members of the family, and thus appropriated the authority of these princes to emphasize the high status of Christian II. As to the patron, it is more likely to be Margaret of Austria than Christian II, because at that time she was much more aware of the political power of portraiture than Christian was. However, she taught him, I will argue, how to use portraiture and pictures in general as political weapons in the struggle for power and glory. And he made well use of this new knowledge in the years to come. And acknowledgements as the last slide. Thank you.